Shabbat Shalom. Well, I'm so happy that you've tuned in with us today at Facebook Live. It's just a blessing how the Lord has given us all this technology in this season and time we're in. We want to wish all of you a very prosperous new year in 2022. If you would like to donate to the ministry, you can click the button above. You can go on our website, wassel.org. You can mail in a check at 2320 East Street or drop off an offering at the church building through the mail slot. We are so blessed at the people that are still supporting the ministry, even in this pandemic, and people that are very generous, that we just can't thank you enough of this last year of craziness happening and things being closed down, that the Lord has paid every bill of Without Spot or Wrinkle Ministry.
Amen.
So we're so blessed, and we thank each and every one of you for your generous donations, because it really keeps the doors open. It keeps us traveling to all the places that the Lord leads us. It helps pay for the conferences, because as you know, we don't charge for any conferences, but there is a cost to the ministry. And so we just are so grateful for your support. As I get into the new year, I kind of, inside of me, it's like I struggle a little bit, because I know now on a lunar calendar, which is Israel's calendar, and which is the Elohim of Israel, the Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, he told Moses that Passover was the new year. And we see at Rosh Hashanah, Israel celebrates a new year. Israel, the teaching about the new year at Rosh Hashanah in September is that that is when God created all of heaven and earth. And so where do we get January 1st? Well, again, we go back to Rome. It's amazing how much that we haven't known of what's been changed of the Word of God. But the Romans changed it to January 1st, and a lot of times they were still celebrating it in March and not in January. But the reason they chose January is because it's a pagan god of, let me see his name here, Junus. And Junus has two faces. And it makes sense why they would choose that, because it's appropriate to start the new year with the month could symbolically, one face could look backwards and one face forward. And so that's why they chose Junus as the pagan god for January 1st. But I know for many of us that we obviously are living in America, we're living in the world, we can't just pluck ourselves out and choose not to live on this calendar, that it's a solar calendar. Israel goes by a lunar calendar. But for America and for us, it is 2022. Now, I don't know about all that you guys have went through in 2021, but it's been a hard year. So many people have gotten sick. People have lost jobs. People have lost loved ones. Many people have died in 2021. And so our heart goes out with you as we start this fresh new year, that if you've gone through all those tribulations and hard times, that we pray that this coming year will be so much better. Now, some of you is like, no, Dr. Patricia, it's been a great year. Ministry's been happening and God's prospered me or prospered my family. And I pray that if that's the case, that you would continue being prosperous and good health as you move into 2022. I know that it's going to be a season like we've never seen before. Each year brings its own struggles and trials and tribulations. And as we see prices going up and things happening and things changing, we know that it's going to be a new season for us. But I want to reassure you one thing. Your Abba Daddy doesn't change. He's still on the throne. So if we have more sickness and disease and more things coming, just know that your Father hasn't left you. He's always there with you. The trials and tribulations, or even a financial squeezing, your Father is your provider. The world system isn't your provider. The kingdom of God is separate from the kingdom of this world. And so I want you to know that your Father, your maker and your husband, your bridegroom, is your provider. So as things change, I know the word of God says in the prayer that Yeshua taught his disciples to pray, pray for your daily bread. Trust in your Father as we move into this new season, because he's never changed. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And as I look back on church history and on the history all the way back to Moses and Adam and Eve, people have gone through struggles at every generation, through every year. And we're going to get through all of these struggles and trials and tribulations. And as the word says, count it all joy. Because God is working out a completeness in us. If it's financial, God wants you to know he's your provider. He's your healer. He's your deliverer. He's your sanctifier. You are not rejected or alone. He's always with you. So I just want to encourage you as we go into this new year to know that your Father is with you and he doesn't change. Amen. With that, we're going to go into our teaching today. And the title of this teaching, the Lord really laid on my heart to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. What a title for going into 2022. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. So he's going to take us to scripture today, and he's going to help us understand how we can be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. So would you open in prayer with me, bow your heads. Heavenly Father, we just thank you. Abba Daddy, we thank you. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever. And that you have a now word for us, the bride. That you've not left us. You've not abandoned us. We're not orphans, Father. We've been adopted. And Father, that you have a message for us. So I ask today, Abba, that you would speak from your heart, through my heart, through my mouth, to the hearts and the minds of your people today, Father. That you would fill the house, the car, the office, wherever people are listening to this live broadcast or see it later, that you would fill the atmosphere up with your presence and your shalom peace, Father. For only your peace will get us through all that we're going to go through, Father. That Yeshua, you're the Prince of Peace, Prince of Shalom, peace that passes all understanding. So I pray that peace upon us today, Father. I pray for the power of your Holy Spirit, that every word would be anointed, every word would touch the hearts and the minds of people that are listening today, in Yeshua's name. Amen. Amen. So let me ask you a question. If the word says be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, how do we do that? How do we get to a place with no matter what's coming or what we have to walk through, how do we become strong in the Lord and the power of his might? Well, I'm going to take you to Ephesians 1, and as you're turning there, I want to talk to you a little bit about Yeshua, because at that last Passover Seder dinner, and some of you know it as the Last Supper, but it was a Seder dinner. He was in Jerusalem, and he's Jewish, and he kept all the feast days. But at that Seder dinner, he knew that Judas was going to betray him. He knew Judas was going to sell him for money. And it was amazing, as I read that portion of scripture, what I pick up. And the Lord took me to that scripture one day. And the scripture says that Yeshua knew who he was, knew where he was going and where he had come from. And then it goes on to say, even after Judas was going to sell him out, he went to the disciples and he started washing their feet. And he was showing them that they needed to be like their rabbi Yeshua, be a servant of all. And then he told them that people would know that we're the disciples if we have love for one another. Now, when I read that portion of scripture, I thought about myself. I thought about how would I handle it if I took 12 people, spent 3.5 years with them, poured into their life, taught them scripture, taught them how to do inner healing and deliverance, and worked hard at pouring into them and giving them everything I could, and then one of my own was going to go and sell me out. And I thought, Lord, I don't think I would go and wash the other's disciples' feet. I think I would go to them whining. Oh my gosh, I gave him the best years of my ministry and I can't believe he would do this to me. And do you guys know what he's going to do tonight? I think I would probably run my mouth a little bit. How about you? But what the Lord started showing me is I had to know who I am in him, where I came from and where I was going. And so I'm going to take you today to give you some scripture to help you see who you are, because it's amazing when we start understanding who we are in our position, who we are in our position in Messiah and this kingdom that we've been brought into. So turn your Bibles to Ephesians 1, starting at verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. How much do I speak about love? In love, having predestined us to adoption as sons of Jesus Christ to himself according to the good pleasure of his will. What does adoption mean? It means legally taking someone else's child and raising them as your own. You know, as I minister to so many people have a spirit of an orphan spirit on them. The orphan spirit is not having a mother and a father, but even if we had a mother and a father, if they weren't there for us, they didn't give us that love, they didn't give us that care. So the Lord wants us to know first we're adopted. We're adopted by the power of the blood of Yeshua. And adoption means that he willfully went after you. He willfully took you to be his own, which is so amazing to me because the word says, even when our mother and father forsakes us, he never will. He says that a mother could forget her nursing baby. He says, even if a mother could forget her nursing baby, look, I've put your name on the palm of my hand. Just think about that for a minute. Your name is written on your Heavenly Father's hand, and that he could never forget you, even if a nursing mother could forget her child. Well, I've been a nursing mama, and believe me, when it's time to feed that baby, you go looking for that baby, and the baby doesn't have a choice at that point. So he says, even if a mother, a nursing mother, could forget, he could never forget you. He loves you so much. So he's adopted you. Verse 6, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the beloved. Precious ones, I would say, with all the counseling I've done and all the traveling and all the people I've ministered to, I would say probably about 95% of the people have a spirit of rejection and abandonment. That so many people have felt unwanted and unloved by their natural parents. Maybe the parents were together, but the pregnancy was to them out of season, or dad was never around, or dad left after mom got pregnant, or dad had another family and had other children. So many scenarios that cause us to feel rejected, even in our mother's womb. And my own life growing up, I felt rejected in my own home. I was the youngest of five, and my father adored me, but he was a stepfather to my siblings, and he wasn't very nice to them. And so at times, I felt like my mother rejected me because she was seeing her children that she brought into the marriage wasn't being treated fairly. Then in school, because of the way I was raised with poverty and alcoholism and my parents and bad hygiene, I was rejected through school. I was rejected so much from so many people, and of course I was always looking for that love. One day I sat down with scripture and I read this scripture. I'm accepted. I'm accepted. And I must have read that scripture 1,000 times. And it dawned on me that if God, the Elohim of Israel, the King of the universe, the creator of all of heaven and earth, if he accepts us, then it doesn't matter who rejects us. We are accepted by the King of the universe. And you know, scripture helps break the bondage. The truth is what sets us free. So the Lord started showing me, why am I trying to get accepted from people that don't have anything to give me? If 95% of the people have rejection and abandonment, they're going to reject you. And then sometimes if we have a spirit of rejection, we do things that's so hard to be around that people reject us. I know, you know, that saying, be careful what you pray for, because you might get it. Well, Reverend Ben years ago wanted a Rottweiler. And they, at the time for us, it was pretty expensive. And I kept praying for my husband to have a Rottweiler. And one day he told me that they had confiscated a Rottweiler from a drug house, and none of the people in the house wanted to claim it because then they had to say that it was their drug house. And he went through all the process to adopt the dog. And that dog had been neglected in the backyard. In fact, it looked hungry and all kinds of things, and it was tied up way in the backyard. And when we brought the dog home, he thought it was a lap dog. And every time I would walk outside, this big Rottweiler would just kind of jump on me and want love and want attention and want to be cared for. And I would beat it down. It's like, get off of me. It was, if I sit down, he would want to jump in my lap thinking he was a lap dog. And it's like pushing this dog away. It's like, you're just too big and too much for me. And as I went in the house one day, I'm thinking, God, that dog, God. And the Lord said to me, that's how people are when they're trying to get loved. They sometimes overpower us to the point we push them away or beat them down to get rid of them because they're too hard to deal with. And the Lord said, we do that in the spiritual realm many times, or the physical realm, trying to get people to accept us and love us. We could be pretty hard to deal with. But the Lord... You're accepted. You're not rejected. Your Father has never left you, and he's your Heavenly Father. And many times, what the Lord has taught me is if our earthly father was hard or not there or mean or demanding or even loving, that we dress God in our earthly father's clothes. We so often think that that's who he is. Many people will come to me for ministering and they have a relationship with Yeshua or Jesus, but they don't have a relationship with God. They don't even know that God is their father, that he is their provider. And so I really want you to know today who the Elohim of Israel is, because he's adopted you, he loves you, and you are accepted by him. Verse 7, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. Now, when I first came to the Lord, I was looking for love in all the wrong places. I don't know about you guys, but not only was I looking for love, but I was doing a lot of things that continued to hurt my own soul and sin. Because when you're looking for love and you're hurting, I was into alcohol and I would drink so I could go sin. And then the next day I'd feel miserable and I'd get drunk so I'd forget the misery of the night before and what I did. There was so much guilt and shame on me. Regret of all the things that I did, of looking for love in all the wrong places. Things that I had done to people. I had hurt people. Not only did people hurt me, but I brought a lot of heartache to a lot of people because I didn't have anything to give people. I didn't have that love or that acceptance that only the Lord can give us. And so here we see by his blood, we're forgiven of our sins. Wow. That is amazing, and I don't think we really understand the fullness of what he's done for us at Calvary, of healing us, delivering us, and forgiving us, and that's why we can forgive others. He made us to abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known to us the mystery of his will. See, before Calvary, before Messiah stepped in, he's a Jewish Messiah. All of Israel was waiting for their Messiah, and a lot of them still are because they don't understand the mystery of Yeshua HaMashiach. They don't understand that he's the bridegroom that's come to sit on the throne of Israel, of Jerusalem, that he's come to redeem Israel. And so we as believers, God has shown us what this mystery is. It's amazing when we think that today in this society, that we know who Messiah is, that we've received him as Lord and Savior. Do you understand what a great gift your Father's given to you? For you to be able to pray and talk to the King of the universe, the creator of all of heaven and earth, that he's redeemed us. He's brought us in to his kingdom. Wow. I don't think sometimes we realize how powerful that blood is or how powerful that redemption is. But just like he took the children of Israel out of Egypt, he's taken us out of the world from the taskmaster of Satan to set us free, that we don't have to be in slavery to sin anymore. Verse 9, again, having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself, that in the disposition of the fullness of the times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth in him. In him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, that we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of his glory. We've been given an inheritance. We need to understand that our roots go back to Israel, not to Rome. We have an incredible inheritance as we go back to the Abraham to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We go back to Abraham, Father Abraham. Our inheritance is in this great kingdom that God brought the children of Israel into. And we've been grafted into that kingdom. As Paul tells us, we've been grafted into the olive tree. Amen. Verse 13, in him you also trusted. Say trusted. That's a big word. A lot of people have a really hard time trusting the Elohim of Israel because they've dressed the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in their earthly parents' clothes. So they have a hard time trusting that he's there for them, that he's not a mean God or a hard God. So trust can be a big word if you've been raised in abuse, if you've never known a loving father, if you've never known the loving hands of a loving father. To trust is a big word. Maybe your earthly father was a good father, but just absent. Sometimes we don't comprehend this word trust. And many of us, if you really get serious, it's going to be hard to trust something you can't see. So let's read that again. In him, you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. In him, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. Precious ones, before Reverend Ben and I got married, he gave me an engagement ring. The Holy Spirit is like the down payment or the engagement ring to the bride of Messiah coming back for us. He told his disciples, you know, what are you so sad about? I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I'm coming back. But he left his Holy Spirit with us to teach us truth, to take us into his kingdom, to give us the power to read his word, to understand. But it's like a down payment. And he's coming back for us. And so he sealed us in the Holy Spirit. But I want to take you to the word trust again. And I want to take you to Jeremiah 17, starting at verse 5. Because as the Lord had to teach me, I had to trust in him with all of my heart and not lean on my own understanding, but acknowledge him in everything, and he would direct my path. But the word trust again comes up. So he took me to Jeremiah 17, starting at verse 5. I recommend you reading all of chapter 17. It's an amazing chapter. Thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart departs from the Lord. See, many times we take God off the throne of our heart and put man on the throne of our heart. And we're looking to man to give us everything. Everything that our parents didn't give us, everything of all the lack that we have. We're looking for this person to be our salvation. And it goes on to say that our heart departs from the Lord because our eyes are now on a person or people, and maybe a pastor, maybe a best friend, maybe a mate. But your eyes are on that person and not on the Lord. And what we do is we take God off the throne of our heart and we put people on the throne of our heart. For going into verse 6, for he shall be like a shrub in the desert and shall not see when good comes. You know, as the Lord's teaching us to have an attitude of gratitude, we just start looking at all the negative and we can't see any good. We start complaining and murmuring when we have so much good around us. If we woke up in the morning and we breathed in and we have breath in our lungs, wow, that's good. If we could see, if we could walk, if we could make a cup of coffee and sit down, all the good around us. But what happens when we make man our strength and trust in man? Pretty soon we don't see all the good around us. We start becoming very negative. But shall inherit the parched places in the wilderness in a salt land which is not inhabited. Now, for me, What the Lord showed me is when my trust was in man and not in God, I was like a shrub out in the wilderness. And he said to me, we live in California, we lived in California, and we would go out to the desert place, and you would see these big bushes come up, but their root system was so shallow. And when the sun would come out, that root system would dry up. And then that big shrub, guess what? It becomes a tumbleweed. And what the Lord showed me was when my trust was in man and trying to get man to accept me, trying to get people to say, I'll be your friend, or you're good, I can see good in you, or it's okay. When I looked to man and I trusted man, I was like that shrub and I would become a tumbleweed in my emotions. Have you ever become a tumbleweed in your emotions? I would just be blown everywhere, and at times it felt like I was dangling and out of space, and I was just gonna fall any second, any time. And the Lord would say, you're not gonna fall, I have you. But I still felt like I couldn't get my feet on the ground. I felt just tumbling all over emotionally. Have you ever felt that way? Well, let me ask you, if you felt that way, is man on the throne of your heart? And have you put all your trust in man and made man your strength and your savior? And you've taken God off the throne of your heart? Well, I want to take you to the next scripture, because this is where God has started having me live in this next scripture. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord. Do we even understand our salvation, our redemption, the blood, the trust in the Lord? The trust in the Lord. Blessed is the man whose trust is in the Lord, whose hope is in the Lord, not in government, not in our job, not in the world system, not in our spouse, not in our lover, not in our children, not the people around us, but in the Lord. For he shall be like a tree planted by the waters, which spreads out its roots by the river, and will not fear when heat comes, but its leaf will be green and will not be anxious. Say the word anxious. So many people are coming and saying, Dr. Patricia, I just have this anxiety on me. I can't get this anxiety off me. I'm always anxious about things. Will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor will cease from yielding fruit. Precious ones, the Lord wants us to go from that shrub in the desert place and being tossed around emotionally to over here a tree with its roots deep in living water, bearing fruit for his kingdom and for his glory. And think about a tree versus a shrub in the desert. Now, when the winds of change comes, when storms come, now I know I've seen some trees get blow over, but most of the trees stay solid no matter what storm comes. Now, if we're over trusting man, when storm comes, we're going to be blown all over the place. But let's go back to a tree with its roots deep in living water producing fruit. Precious ones, we need to grow up in Christ at this time, because churches could be closed down. Bibles could become against the law. With the internet censorship that's happening in America, you might not be able to get to a pastor. You might not be able to get to your best friend to pray for you. You might not get to somebody that can feed you. But you need to be that person with roots deep in living water, that you can bear fruit and minister to others, that you would have such faith and such trust that when the Father says, pray for the sick, that you won't doubt him. But God, what if the sick doesn't get healed? And what are they going to think about me? But what if they do get healed? What happens if you have 25 people come to your house and you only have a tiny bit of spaghetti because all hell's broke loose in our world? Do you have enough faith and hope in the Father that you could pray over that and it be multiplied? That we're the ones that need to be bearing fruit because we're the bride. And many of us in the bride have been in the bride for quite some time now, for many years. And God wants us to trust in him and hope in him and become that tree that we're solid, that we can be glorifying him, that we can be the ones that people are coming to eat from our fruit, that we can pour into people. What happens when the baptism of the Holy Spirit, or that tidal wave of the Holy Spirit comes, like I know it's going to come? Are you mature enough to be taking newborn babes in and teaching them the word of God and praying for them and becoming that person that's ministering to them instead of the one being ministered to? We need our eyes off of man and back on the Lord. Remember scripture last week? Put your eyes on the things above, not the things below. And so we need to start becoming this tree that God wants to create us to be, but our trust needs to be in him. Amen? Now back to Ephesians, and we're going to start at verse 15 here. Paul's telling us to get spiritual wisdom. Therefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of Yeshua, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. Precious ones, the bride today needs the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. Because we're so malnourished. I've seen the bride literally in a hospital bed on life support. And unless we get that wisdom and knowledge of who we are in him and who he is and who we belong to, we're going to be along with the people on life support spiritually. Verse 18, and the eyes of your understanding being enlightened. It's time for us to come out of darkness all the way out of the world and into his glorious light, that you may know what is the hope of his calling. What is the hope of his calling for you? You have a purpose and a plan. You're the bride. We're to be mature. Many of us are still babes in Christ. I remember Paul saying, I can only give you milk. Many of you are to be teachers already. And now I got to go back and just feed you milk. God is saying to the bride this year, step into your calling. Step into your position. Cut out darkness and the world. Get rid of the sin. Get rid of the garbage that's holding you back from the maturity of the bride that you're supposed to be. I'm going to read that again. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe according to the working of his power. Say his power. Which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above principalities and power and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things, say all things,
all things,
under his feet. And he gave him to be head over all things in the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. One day, years ago, when God was growing me up and healing me and delivering me and letting me know that I'm accepted in the Lord and who I am in him, it was a hard journey because we go through trials and tribulations and hardship. And the Lord says, count it all joy. Mm-hmm. And one day I was walking around my house depressed, hopeless, discouraged. I was murmuring and complaining, saying, God, it's it, I'm done. My house payment was $4,000 a month in 1980. I couldn't afford to feed my kids. I was working 3 and 4 jobs. I was chasing teenagers, and I had 2 babies 16 months apart. And I just walked around going, I'm done. Just take me, God. That's over. I hopeless, despair, anxiety, all that hit me. And as I was speaking and walking around my house, the Holy Spirit got a hold of me and shook some common sense into me. And the Lord said to me, you are not defeated. You stand in resurrection power. And he showed me like if I were transported right into Yeshua, just into his body. He said, Yeshua, at the time, Jesus, is not depressed. He's not hopeless. He's not anxiety. He doesn't need Prozac. You walk in resurrection power. You stand in this resurrection power. What is resurrection power? It raised Yeshua from the dead on the 3rd day. Yeshua is not defeated, and neither are we.
Amen.
We are in him, seated in heavenly places, and all principalities and powers and dominions and wickedness is under our feet. We are in delegated authority in his kingdom. We are not defeated. We walk in resurrection power.
Amen.
Oh, if the church, the bride, could only understand this. Do you know what happened to me that day? All the lies of the enemy was destroyed. Depression left. Suicide left. Discouragement, hopelessness, despair, all left. That if we're in him, we walk in power. Is there something you're addicted to? Is there drugs? Is there alcohol? Is there pornography? Are you hooked into some kind of bondage that you need to be set free from? You walk in resurrection power, and you can ask to be delivered from anything that's holding you in bondage. Many times God is waiting for you to get sick of it, to hate sin the way he hates sin, because usually that's going to be turned around for your message, and you're going to minister what you went through to other people. Precious ones, we walk in resurrection power, and we need to understand our authority in the kingdom. You have been betrothed to the King of the universe. You have been brought into a kingdom as Queen Esther had been brought in for such a time as this. Do we understand this resurrection power, this authority that we walk in? I don't think we do as the bride, but God wants us to know that we're in him and we walk in this resurrection power. Go to chapter 2 of Ephesians. And you he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. See, we can't be disobedient to walk in this kingdom with resurrection power. We need to know his will for us. We need to surrender our lives 100% and become that tree and not that bush out in the desert place. I want you to go to Ephesians 4. And I'm going to have to start closing it up. Ephesians 4, verse 1. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love. Precious ones, I can't stress love enough. Satan wants us divided. A house divided cannot stand. If we're not bearing with one another and giving each other grace and forgiving one another, Satan wants to come in our homes, our marriages, our churches, ministries. He wants us to live in our past hurts and pains, and we're offended by the slightest of things, and we're going to break relationships. God wants us in unity, and we need to walk in the calling which we were called and put our mind on the things above and not the things below. With lowliness, that means not having pride, arrogance, self-righteousness, that we're so perfect that everybody else is not perfect as they should be. We need to have grace for one another. Gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love. And last week we talked about love. If you missed that one, you need to go back and hear that teaching. Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, of shalom. There is one body and one Spirit, just as we were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all, and through all, in you all. See, Satan has divided us by putting us in Rome. There shouldn't be all the denominations and non-denominations. There's thousands today. There's only one God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Yeshua HaMashiach is the Jewish Messiah. The Ruach HaKodesh is the Holy Spirit that was promised, that came at Pentecost. And precious ones, we need to go back to Rome. I mean, we need to come out of Rome and go back to Israel, because there's only one God, one Holy Spirit, and one Messiah. Amen?
Amen.
Now I want you to drop down to Ephesians 5. I'm going to take you all the way down to Ephesians 5, 25, just to start closing this up. He's talking first to wives that we're to submit to our husbands, and I believe that that's still true today. But husbands are to love their wives as Christ loves the church. And then it goes on to say in verse 25, husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. Verse 32 says, this is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. See, Satan hates marriage. He hates it because it represents Christ and the bride of Christ, the church, the body of Christ. Amen? Mm-hmm. So now we're going to drop down to verse 10. Finally, after we know who we are and we can trust in him and take our mind off of man, man's going to disappoint you. Man's going to reject you. Man's going to leave you. And I'm speaking even to pastors today. You can't walk around with a spirit of rejection and not be healed and be a pastor, because people are going to leave your congregation and you're going to have to love them unconditionally no matter what. And we need to love unconditionally with his hesed love. But we need to know who we are, put our trust in him, become that tree. That tree that has our roots deep in living water that we can bear fruit. Now, verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. That's how we're going to do it. We need to understand who we are. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. We're in spiritual warfare. Our battle is not with flesh and blood, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand, therefore, stand. That tree with roots in living water. We don't have to be tossed around by what man is doing. Our battle is not with man. It's with these principalities. Having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness. That word righteousness in Hebrew, and I know we're in the New Testament, but there was no New Testament when Paul was speaking this and writing this. That word righteous means keeping loving instructions from Torah. Girding our waist with truth. Precious ones, we can't live in this counterfeit system of Rome and call it truth. We can't live in tradition of man and pagan gods and call it truth. We're at a time that we need to mature and grow up as the bride. We have to let go of childish things and parables and fables from wise tales and tradition of man that makes the word of God to no effect. We need the truth of God. And having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of shalom. And again, we've looked at that word shalom. It's deliverance, it's healing, it's restoration. There's so much more to it than just the peace that we have in our English language. Above all, taking the shield of faith. You know, I remember believing what the demons were telling me and having faith in what the demons told me and doubting God. I remember praying from doubt. Lord, heal my father, but I know he's an alcoholic and I know he'll never be healed. I pray for salvation for my father, but he's such a dirty old man and such a drunk and such a this and such a that. I know you'll never answer that, Lord. Do we pray from doubt? Are we praying from faith? Do we have faith? Do we trust? The Lord showed me I had more faith than what the demons told me, and I doubted what the word of God told me. And I remember one day praying, Lord, give me a spirit of faith. Let me have faith in you and faith in your word. Let me have faith in your kingdom. You know, he gave it to me. But we need to have our shield of faith. And what does that mean? I mean, when the enemy's throwing fiery darts and telling you you're rejected and nobody cares and nobody loves you and nobody's with you and everybody's going to hurt you and it's always like this. You pull up that shield of faith and you start speaking the word back to those demons because you're in spiritual warfare and they're sending darts out at you. You need to start coming back in faith and speaking to those demons that are talking to you and tell them to shut up and depart. With which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. I remember the Lord, one time I said, Lord, I don't know what's wrong. I have a heart that feels like 150 pounds. My mind's grinding over something that happened. I'm not angry. I'm not holding this person in unforgiveness, but my mind won't shut up. And my heart's heavy. And the Lord says, a fiery dart. Quench the fire. Pull it out. Send it to the the abyss. Ask for the living water from under the throne room of God to cleanse that pain. And then heal it with the blood of Yeshua. That faith is going to quench those fiery darts. Take up the helmet of salvation. Remember the word salvation all the way back when Moses was bringing the children of Israel out of Egypt at the Red Sea, the army behind them. I could imagine the terror on them. And Moses said, stand still, fear not. See the salvation of the Lord. That word, salvation, is Yeshua. It's deliverance, it's healing, it's restoration. It's so much more than just fire insurance. And the supplication of the Spirit being watchful. Wait, and the sword of the Spirit, which is your word. We need to have the word in us. Most believers could hold up a handkerchief or a tissue and say, in the name of Jesus, I command you to leave. Those demons laugh at us because we don't know enough of the word. Our sword is sharpened by the word. God's not giving you a spirit of fear, but love, power, and a sound mind. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything be thankful, making your requests known to him. Oh, that you're loved, you're not rejected, you're accepted, you've been adopted. What's the word tell us? We're healed. He bore our griefs and our sorrows. We need the word. Verse 18, praying always with prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end, with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. In closing, I want to read Romans 8, 38, 39. I want you to listen to these words and put them to memory for this coming year. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love, the hesed love of the Elohim of Abraham, which is in Yeshua, our Lord. I'm going to pray for you. I'm asking Pastor Anthony to come up and bless us with his blessing today. Father, we just thank you. Father, put our trust in you. Give us a spirit of faith. Let our roots be deep in living water that we will not cease to bear fruit. Father, we thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your spiritual blessings in all things. In Yeshua's name, amen. I'm welcoming up Pastor Anthony to bless you today.
Yisa Adonai panaf elecha b'chunecha. Yisa Adonai panaf elecha b'yasim b'chal shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord's countenance be upon you. And may he give you peace.
Amen.